On the first day of 2020, most of us had never heard the word coronavirus. And then...
The new strain of coronavirus can spread from person to person.
The deadly coronavirus is spreading. Breaking news, the deadly coronavirus is now in New Zealand.
I understand that all of this rapid change creates anxiety, especially when it means changing how we live.
Climate change is going to make COVID-19 look like a picnic on a summer's day, the scale of it.
As bad as the pandemic has been, the climate crisis could be far, far worse. So, how do we fix it?
Climate change is fundamentally an economics question. Capitalism was founded on carbon. Everything we do that involves carbon dioxide has to change if we want to hit 1.5 degrees.
In 2016, most nations signed the Paris Agreement, agreeing to limit climate change to 1.5 degrees, a big win. In 2019, we passed the Zero Carbon Act, which sets out a framework for all of our systems to reach net carbon zero by 2050.
Climate change is the biggest challenge of our time.
Two big wins, problem solved, right? Well, in 2017, this guy hauled the US out of the Paris Agreement. And back home, the Zero Carbon Act has been criticised for not being tika, for failing the principles of te tiriti.
It was a step in the right direction, but unfortunately it didn't embrace this idea of a treaty partnership or a treaty relationship between the Crown and Māori, which, when you think of the impacts of climate change across Aotearoa, are pretty fundamental to every decision that's going to be made.
Carbon, capitalism and colonisation. For many, they're the same thing.
A lot of the thinking which underpins capitalism and colonisation has led to certain activities which have basically destroyed the environment. And so a lot of that is around maximising economic profit, which is a very short-term activity and means you just don't think about the sorts of costs that you're externalising to the environment.
Costs like greenhouse gas emissions.
Capitalism can work. It's just about making sure that we do put a price on those negative costs.
Within the OECD, the biggest overall emitters are who you might expect, like the US and Russia. But per capita, New Zealand is in the top 5 worst emitters of all OECD countries.
Emissions per capita are really important because it shows just how unsustainable the lifestyles that we're leading are. If every person in the world had an emissions per person as high as New Zealand, we would be absolutely on our way to a 4-degree world.
Our emissions profile is a little bit unique. 40% of our total comes from energy, almost half of which is driving. We just can't get out of our cars, except during a global pandemic.
During lockdown, when the skies cleared, there were some studies that were produced that showed how many lives were improved because of this reduced air pollution. The World Health Organization estimates that 7 million people a year die from air pollution. And the drivers of air pollution are the same drivers as climate change in a lot of cases.
But even if the future is carless, our emissions would still be sky high because our biggest emitting industry by far, at nearly half the total, is agriculture.
I mean, let's face it, we turned this country into one big farm, essentially. Mowed down all the forests, covered the place in sheep and cows.
Breeding, killing, and selling livestock has made us wealthy.
Our barbecue is prepared with just the right amount of heat to keep in the natural juices and hold in that wonderful flavor. So come on, boys and gals, let's have a barbecue.
But change is mandating change, and one big change is underway. In 2014, only 4% of New Zealanders were always or mostly meat-free. Only 5 years later, that number spiked to 15%.
Trends towards eating less meat, less dairy, might play a really big part in changing the fabric of our agricultural economy.
And farmers are listening. Regenerative agriculture is a boom industry. A recent report claimed that almost all farms in Aotearoa have been made more sustainable.
We don't want an end to farming, of course. We don't want to throw all the farmers out of the country. But we do want discussions about land use and what's the most suitable use of our land for food production.
Is the fix as simple as a shift towards lower emissions industries? Maybe. But as temperatures rise, maybe not.
With climate change, there'll be increasing numbers of pests coming into the country and threatening key taonga species like pohutukawa and manuka, you know, key to Māori culture and identity and well-being, but also key in an economic sense.
One pest that's tried very hard to invade us, the Queensland fruit fly.
One of the main advantages we have is our winters are just too cold for them to survive, and so even if you have an outbreak, they might die over winter naturally, and then you'll kind of reset that baseline.
This tiny bug could wipe out our $6 billion horticulture industry, and it has a taste for kiwi fruit. The Bay of Plenty, Aotearoa's kiwi fruit capital, growing 80% of the country's annual harvest. Recently, environmental scientists modelled how climate change could create a more suitable habitat for our little Aussie fly. Present optimal ranges are shown here in red. Even now, some of the region is optimal. Even if we do keep emissions low, by 2065 those optimal areas bloom. And in a moderate emissions future, with high emissions, by 2100, almost everywhere is optimal, and not only in the Bay of Plenty, but in all of Te Ka Māui.
Greenhouse gases are produced by basically every sector of the economy, which means every sector is a part of the problem, and it means that every sector can be a part of the solution.
Fundamentally transforming our economy to deal with climate change, it's going to mean that the economy of 2050 is going to have to look really different to the economy of today.
Our current economic system is shaped like a line. Finite resources are obtained, processed, goods are consumed, and thrown away. The system moves forward in its quest for growth. Take, make, use, dispose. But what if it was a circle? Circular systems focus on renewable resources, durability of goods, and waste reduction. Ecological health is equal to economic growth. In a circular system, all things are interconnected. Grow, make, use, return.
Regenerative agriculture, systems thinking, a circular economy. The values that are encompassed in those ideas already exist in a lot of tikanga Māori and Māori ways of looking at the world.
To decolonise and decarbonise is increasingly seen as the same action, especially as awareness grows that climate change more deeply impacts Indigenous peoples.
Some governments are now just setting that out as though there's nothing you can do about that, that Indigenous peoples are most vulnerable, and that's really sad, and then there's kind of some hand-wringing that goes along with that, instead of policies which work towards more equal and fair solutions.
The way in which we can try and address that is to enable Māori to be part of those solutions, to not have solutions dictated or placed upon them.
Because, as the pandemic showed us, no one is safe unless we're all safe, and change is made by many, not by a few.
New Zealand is a really small emitter. You know, globally, we are tiny in terms of the amount of emissions. However, collectively, small emitters, like New Zealand, account for a really significant proportion of global emissions.
In fact, small emitters are responsible for nearly one-third of global emissions. If they all reached net zero, it would make a larger impact than any single country's goal.
Individuals can only have a very slight impact on climate change when they act alone. But when they act collectively, that's when we can have the kind of impact that we really need to be seeing.
All of us, collectively, can make change.
So there's a range of household emission calculators in New Zealand that allow households or individuals to calculate their personal emissions. And they're not perfect, but they don't have to be perfect to be useful. And when we start to look at our footprint, we realize, ah, okay, here's where the opportunities are for me to change my behavior.
Total policy change is not going to happen without individuals demanding action. What I think is critical is getting young people to vote, because old people who benefit from the current economic structure, who benefit from the way that we're dealing with climate change now, they're the ones who vote.
Talk about it with your family, with your kids, with your folks, with your partner. Take it to your school, your workplace, around the smoker room table. And let's face it, you know, no one's going to escape this.
2020 has been a hell of a year.
2020 has frankly been terrible.
But if there is a silver lining, maybe the pandemic gave us a blueprint for how to solve the climate crisis.
It showed what can be done with concerted action.
Just imagine if we had had, say, like 2 years lead-in time to prepare for COVID-19, how different things would have been. With climate, we do have that lead-in time. We do have the opportunity to plan for it, and we do have the opportunity to take action.
That opportunity should give us all some cause for hope.
I think it's because I can see the solutions that I don't give up hope. And to me, the action on climate change is going to accelerate when we each look at ourselves in the mirror and start with four easy words. How can I help?
Because the future is coming, and what Aotearoa looks like in 100 years isn't someone else's problem. It's ours. Māori ora kia tātou.